Good afternoon. Victoria Road has been shut down in both directions this afternoon after a dramatic bus crash in Drummoyne. The bus mounted a median strip at the Lyons Road intersection, smashing in the windscreen and ending up balancing precariously on two wheels. The passengers had to be helped out of the unstable vehicle and a man was trapped in a ute. Luckily, though, everyone is now okay. Three people were taken to hospital for minor injuries, but the crash caused major delays in the area. All lanes are now back open. He stayed silent for 5 years, but today Marcelo Santoro has confessed to strangling his ex-girlfriend in Sydney in 2018. A jury this afternoon convicting the Brazilian national of aggravated murder. Our US correspondent Lauren Tomasi was in the Rio courtroom as the verdict was handed down.
After confessing his crime to the court, Marcelo Santoro has just been convicted of aggravated murder of Cecilia Haddad. The chilling confession from the Brazilian national came as he faced a Rio courtroom 5 years after killing his ex-partner and dumping her body in Sydney's Lane Cove River. 45-year-old Santoro telling the federal court that in April 2018, after secretly making a copy of her house key, he entered Cecilia Haddad's Ryde apartment without her permission. The pair got into an argument, Santoro admitting to moving in her direction to shut her up, saying he grabbed her neck and squeezed until she fell into his arms. Do you want to say you're sorry to the family? Marcelo Santoro's lawyer argued there was no intent to kill, but a jury of seven decided differently, convicting the 45-year-old on three counts of aggravated murder. There have been more than a dozen witnesses give evidence in this trial, including three people who revealed the 45-year-old also confessed the crime to them. Three Australian detectives in the courtroom for this case, they say the evidence against Santoro is overwhelming.
I know I speak for the many police that were involved for a long time in this investigation, and it's fantastic to get a conviction. I just can't help but thinking tomorrow's for the family yet another day without Cecilia.
Marcelo Santoro attempted to flee here to Brazil. This afternoon, he is back behind bars. He's now facing a lengthy jail sentence, more than 27 years.
Well, time is fast running out to find the missing Titanic tourist submersible with just a few more hours of oxygen left. Authorities insisted this morning the operation was still a search and rescue mission, but were unable to confirm the source of banging noises that have been detected. The five-person vessel vanished on Sunday on its way to view the wreckage of the Titanic. We'll have more from our US correspondent coming up very shortly. Well, traffic has been banked up for more than 6 kilometres thanks to a four-vehicle crash on the M2 earlier today. It happened near Macquarie Park just after 8 this morning. One woman in her 30s taken to hospital in a stable condition with head and leg injuries. Classic cars, motorcycles and Ferraris have all been seized by Sydney police investigating an alleged cryptocurrency scam. Officers charged a 39-year-old man on Friday after carrying out raids on a home and a warehouse in Cromer in the city's north. It's alleged two companies were defrauded of more than $5.5 million. A 67-year-old man has also been charged. Well, China has hit back after US President Joe Biden referred to President Xi Jinping as a dictator by calling the remarks absurd and political provocation. It comes just days after meetings in China aimed at stabilising relations, which Beijing claims are now at an all-time low. To breaking news in Canberra, Finance Minister Katy Gallagher has just stared down a censure motion in the Senate over accusations she tried to weaponise Brittany Higgins' rape allegations before they were made public. Let's go live to our federal politics reporter, Reece D'Alessandro. Reece, good afternoon. Talk us through what's happened.
And Davina, this accusation Senator Gallagher had prior knowledge of and sought to weaponise Brittany Higgins' rape allegation was just one of the more controversial issues of this last sitting fortnight. The finance minister last week denied she had any involvement in Brittany Higgins' decision to go public, but late today coalition senators have again sought to capitalise on the controversy, attempting to suspend standing orders in the Senate to bring on a censure motion.
President, I seek leave to move a motion relating to the censure of the Minister for Finance.
I informed Senator Reynolds that I had been given a heads up about the allegations in the days before they became public, an explanation she accepted at that time some 2 years ago.
And the motion eventually failed, but it's capped off a sitting fortnight of both delay and distraction. Labor ends this sitting period without a win on its housing legislation. It has been kicked into the long grass and won't be debated again likely until October. And that is because the Greens are still holding out support over the issue of soaring rents, despite the fact the government committed an extra $2 billion in funding for social and affordable housing.
Well, it's disappointing that the Greens put politics before people once again. You know, the Greens had an opportunity not just to talk about social housing but to actually vote for it, and they voted against it.
The Greens are ready and willing to pass the Housing Australia Future Fund bill the moment Labor comes to the table and works out a plan to make unlimited rent increases illegal.
Of course, aside from rising mortgage costs and rising rents, the other big hip pocket pressure this winter will be power prices. They will go up again from July 1. Data from Origin Energy today showing a 50% jump in customers seeking hardship support over the last 12 months. But Labor is confident its power price relief package will be enough to soften the blow. Divina members will return at the end of next month, and the headaches of the last 2 weeks will be here waiting for them.
OK, Rhys, thank you. Well, more than 200,000 Australians are taking part in the Push-Up Challenge, doing hundreds of push-ups every day, pushing the limits for mental health awareness. 270 million push-ups have been completed since the start of the challenge in 2017, with almost $13 million raised towards mental health services. And founder of the challenge, Nick Hudson, joins us now. Nick, this is such a great cause. How does the Push-Up Challenge work?
So the Push-Up Challenge has participants taking on 3,144 push-ups over 23 days. 3,144 to represent the number of Australians who tragically took their own lives in 2021.
Your inspiration obviously coming from a statistic that, shouldn't be that high.
Yeah, absolutely. So we're trying to shine a spotlight on mental health and do what we can to reduce this number year on year in Australia.
It's happening all over the world. Aussies are even doing their part in Antarctica. Tell us more.
Yeah, this year we have over 215,000 participants taking part across Australia, and Aussies taking it on across the world as well, including a number of people in Antarctica. Collectively, we've banked over 200 million push-ups through the event, and we've raised over $13 million for mental health. So, yeah, it has gone a long way across the country.
Congratulations. That is just such an extraordinary effort. Each day, the participants, they receive the number of push-ups they need to do. So it's a physical challenge, but it's also a mental one too. They receive mental health guidance. So what sort of messages do they get?
Yeah, absolutely. So whilst we're asking Australians to take on 3,144 as a total, the number per day, the target number per day, varies to reflect a mental health statistic. So through the event, we're not only encouraging people to complete push-ups and hopefully get active, which can help reduce the chance of mental illness, but we're hoping people can also learn about mental health along the way as well and have some good conversations about what is obviously a very important topic.
It wraps up tomorrow, so what's next?
What's next? Well, people have one more day to complete all their push-ups with this event. Hopefully, last chance to fundraise to make a difference to Lifeline Movember and a Push for Better Foundation. And then, yeah, hopefully everyone's arms get a chance to rest in time for next year's event.
The arms will be weaker, but the mind will be stronger. Nick, thank you so much.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.